So I would like to start this talk with a disclaimer. So this is a seminar on Indian physicists, and I'm neither a physicist nor a chemist. I am a biologist. And so some of the physics equations that are there behind GNR's work, and I will introduce GNR to you in a second, I personally do not understand as well. But what I will try to convey to you in this talk is how his work has impacted biology and many other fields over the years. So before I even go into GNR, how many people in this room have heard of GN Ramachandran before? So I guess I see the older people. None of the younger people seem to know him, which is actually very, very common. Right? So I did not know his name till I was an MSc student, actually. And part of the reason was I actually did my MSc in Tamil Nadu, and my MSc supervisor was, in fact, from University of Madras. And I personally think that's why I know more about him than the average, even biology student. So although we have been talking about how many of our scientists have not got that recognition, we just discussed it just before I came on stage, I think GNR actually falls in a completely different category. He's really not known even amongst the Indian scientific community beyond these niches of people who work on biophysics and so on. And at that I find very interesting. I will not speculate too much. In terms of information about him also, I had a really hard time gathering information to essentially organize this talk. There is much less, much, much less available about him than compared to Saha and Raman and Bose, who are our icons, so to say, of modern India. Having said that, I will try to convey to you using stories about the legacy of GNR. So, we were talking about how Calcutta was a hub, so we'll move down south now. So the Madras hub was another hub of science. And the title of my talk is Madras Contribution to Protein Shapes and Structure. So we'll try to convey some of that. So GNR was actually around till very recently, 2001. And he actually is one of those scientists who has three very different scientific discoveries which you can ascribe to him. And in spite of that, he hasn't really received much recognition in terms of awards, which we can debate if they are important or not. And also in terms of just name recognition, even within the larger scientific community. So the first seminal discovery by him was the triple helical structure of collagen. We'll go through this. The second, which is probably the most famous, is the so-called Ramachandran plot that is still used today. We'll go over that as well. Those of you who have done biophysics protein structure will be very familiar with this plot. And then the third important contribution, there are several more, I just decided to highlight three, are some of these theoretical methods which he came up with to reconstruct 3D to 2D reconstructions using this method called convolution. And this is in fact used in modern CT, MRI methods as well. And you'll see how these have crossed decades. So this work was done in the 50s, this was in the 60s, this was in the 70s. So he had a very long scientific career, and he's worked in very diverse fields and with comparatively less recognition. So before I even go into GNR's life and his stories, I'd just like to introduce this audience, because I'm assuming most of you are from the physical sciences, to what essentially biomolecules are, because much of his work, which I will talk to you about, and especially the first two bullet points that I showed you, are about biomolecules. So what are biomolecules? I'll talk about that. And how do we determine their structure and why that is important? And all that kind of leads into why how Ramachandran contributed to these very important questions. So like even if you do not have a biology background post high school, you will probably remember these molecules from your school textbook. So the four main classes of biomolecules are carbohydrates, lipids, nucleic acids, more commonly DNA, RNA, and proteins. And what you can see from this slide is they're actually just molecules. They're just made up of carbon, of course. All of them have carbon, all of them have hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, some phosphate. So they're essentially just molecules. And so philosophically speaking, we can actually call ourselves bags of molecules. We're just a bag, like a huge bag, like any living organism on the earth. We're just a bag of various molecules which are working together in synchrony and doing all these very, very complex life processes. And just by the, like, even with a very high school level biology understanding, you would you'll know how these biomolecules, which are made of these very simple atoms, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, contribute to these extremely complex life processes. Another thing to note is these are all polymers, as you can see. So this is like a single unit of carbohydrate, but they are connected in chains. Similarly, each of these blue kind of rings is one nucleotide, which is connected by this phosphodiester backbone. This is DNA over here, and this is protein over here, wherein you have these carbon-nitrogen bonds, which are the peptide bonds, which are holding these together. So the bonding is very important. So there are both strong and weak bonds. Again, that is something which you would all appreciate. And some of Ramachandran's work is involved with these bonding patterns. So what I will now focus on is on proteins, because that's what Ramachandran worked on. Most of his focus in terms of the biological sciences was on proteins. So what are proteins? Again, a quick capsule on proteins. So proteins are essentially directly coded by DNA. So in that sense, there is a correlation. So I guess all of you are familiar with gene. The term gene, I think, is very popular now. Genes are essentially sequences of DNA. And these sequences of DNA are, in fact, called the molecular language. And so they're a language which code for proteins. And proteins also have a language. And in DNA, these individual units are nucleotides. Again, these are made up of carbon, phosphate, oxygen, and so on. And each nucleotide is coding for an amino acid, which is essentially the basic unit of a protein. So there are 20 amino acids. I will not go into those, the actual structures of them. But what is very important is the pattern, the sequence of these nucleotides or these amino acids, because they actually dictate the function, the structure of the corresponding molecule. That is essentially because these are physicochemical properties. These are molecules which have carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen. They are following the same bonding patterns that occur all over nature. And those physicochemical relationships dictate the function of those molecules. So in the case of proteins, the amino acid sequence is very important because that is essentially a chemical identity. And so the sequence determines how the protein folds, so the shape of the protein, and essentially which the three-dimensional structure of the protein. And that, again, determines what its final function. So, and a protein can have diverse functions. So anything that a living organism does is essentially conducted by a protein. So name it. It's not like they do a subset of all functions. So metabolic reactions, DNA replication, responding to stimuli, anything that a living organism does is essentially the function of a protein. So I just mentioned about the sequence of a protein folding. So this is essentially that from just a standard textbook. So this is a protein has a hierarchical level of structural organization. So if this is the sequence of amino acids, depending on the physicochemical nature of those individual amino acids, it will fold in certain ways. And protein folding is, again, a very important problem which we still have not solved yet. It'll fold in a certain way to give rise to something which looks like this. We often we hold an analogy to a ball of wool. So it's kind of very flexible, which is why it's able to do these diverse functions and move between an on and off state. It's not a rigid body. And so this flexibility of a protein is something which is very, very important for its final function, is the take-home story of this slide. So again, this is again from a textbook. You can see how proteins, although they are all just made up of those 20 amino acids, can be of various lengths. That's just the length of the chain, but they can also adopt different shapes. And this is just a diverse array of proteins and these are not an artist's imagination. These are actually solved structures. This is just a cartoon rendition of the structure, but this is actually how the molecule looks. So hemoglobin, I think all of you are familiar with, carries oxygen in the blood. Myoglobin, the muscle counterpart, collagen, which we will talk about now, and so on. Each of these proteins has a very unique shape. So the shape of the protein is very important for its final function. That is essentially what I want to say. So how do we determine protein structure? Protein or molecular structures, in the current day, there are a variety of methods to do that. There is NMR, cryo-electron microscopy, and so on. But in the early 20th century, most important method that came about was X-ray crystallography. So this has been around for more than 100 years now. I'll come to another slide to show you how many Nobel Prizes are associated with this. But in very briefly, what X-ray crystallography is you just, so this, you need a crystalline form of your protein. So I'm just talking about proteins. So it could be DNA, it could be another molecule as well. So that is over here, so your sample crystal. You shine X-ray on it, and then it's scattered. You detect the detect it on some kind of a film. This diffraction pattern is then analyzed to get the final electron density map. And what you finally end up with is a model of the molecule, in this case a protein, at atomic resolution. So you actually have details of individual atoms of that molecule. This has been like a completely path-changing method to understand functions of all biomolecules, because at this stage we have atomic level structures of various important proteins, important DNA molecules. Just to give this is from Wikipedia. So these are the total number of Nobel Prizes that have been given to essentially important fundamental questions. These are all biological molecules which involve directly X-ray crystallography. So right from 1914 right to 2012, and these are still going, we are pretty sure there'll be more. There are prizes across all disciplines. This is something we are very proud of. So we have a lot of physicists, chemists, and physiologists who have all won Nobel Prizes for their X-ray crystallography studies of various biomolecules. These are mostly biomolecules right from Bragg, who I think everyone in this room would know. This is the one of the first Nobel Prizes, and when they were looking at simple salt crystals, to Perutz and Kenruch. This was the first protein, this was myoglobin, that was solved in the early, almost 100 years ago, more than 100 years ago, right till 2012, when and more recently, all of these prizes have been won in the past 10 years, where crystallography is still being used to solve structures of macromolecules, and most of these later ones are all proteins. So with all that background, we come back to GNR, a scientist for the day. So I'll just give you a short historical journey of who he was. So GN, of course, stands for Gopala Samudram, which is the village from where he comes from, and Narayana, his father, which is very common in names from that part of the country. He was actually born near Cochin in Ernakulam. I think some of you may be familiar with that part of Kerala. And he did his BSc in physics. So his father was a maths professor. So that was part of the reason why he was interested in mathematics and physics right from a young age. And he went on to do his BSc from Trichy, St. Joseph's College, Trichy. After this, he decided, based on a lot of feedback from his family and so on, that he should move into engineering. So this pressure to do engineering was apparently there even 100 years ago. So his father, who was a maths professor, said, yeah, ISC is there. Go to Bangalore, do a master's in electrical engineering. So that's what he went to do in ISC. But it turns out that he was always interested in physics, and he met Raman in ISC. So he actually, I didn't include this on the slide, but he initially enrolled as a master's in electrical engineering. And there's this anecdote, and I'm not sure if this is true, that Raman wanted him to move to physics. And of course, there was bureaucracy always, and there were some problems. But Raman, given who he was, went to the electrical engineering department in ISC and said that he's too smart to be an electrical engineer. And that apparently helped him move to physics. I don't know if this is true, but I read it in several reports. So irrespective of whether that fact is true, it is true that he finally did move to physics. And he was actually working in the Raman lab for several years. And that is when he got exposed to crystallography, X-ray diffraction, and the methods related to them. He first did his MSc in physics from there. And this was his thesis topic. All of these were with Raman, of course, on optics of heterogeneous media. And then he went on to do his DSc, which is essentially an equivalent of a PhD, from the same lab. And this was his thesis topic. He was working on essentially diffraction methods to not biological molecules yet, so like diamond and so on, diamond zinc blend and so on. At this point, he decided so this was around the time of independence, and so he decided to go to UK, which is what many physicists in those days have done, so go to Europe, basically. So he went to the Cavendish Laboratory in Cambridge University, And this was actually a hotbed of crystallography. So this is where Bragg was in those days. Lawrence Bragg was there. And all these other big names which you hear about, Pauling, everybody was in, at that point hanging around in Cambridge. So he got a second PhD from Cavendish. And this was on, again, X-ray diffraction methods. Although he was in the Cavendish, he didn't get his PhD with Bragg. His PhD was with Wooster and Lang. But of course, he was hanging around with Bragg and Pauling and Dirac and other people who were there in Cambridge at that time. So just the environment of Cambridge influenced him and his growth hugely. So of course, Raman was there. That was his first introduction to this world of large science. And by the time he was in ISC, Raman was already a laureate. So he was already as really famous. When he came to Cavendish, his conversations with Dirac and Pauling and Bragg kind of influenced his future work as well, a lot. And after his PhD, which again, as his second PhD, he came back to ISC as an assistant professor in physics, and he helped set up the X-ray diffraction lab over there. And he was working there. So what happened is around this time, around 52, and by this time, Raman had retired and had moved from ISC and had moved to Raman Research Lab, which I guess is still, which I guess all of you are familiar with. It is still around, and he was contacted by the VC then of Madras University, who wanted to set up this new department of physics in Madras University. So this was actually a very modern-minded VC, if you will, who wanted to set up this, within the Department of Physics, a kind of a focus area on crystallography, which he appreciated was an important area to focus on. So he requested Raman to come back. Raman had his roots in Tamil Nadu as well, but Raman was quite old by then, and he didn't want to really move. And what he did was he asked the VC that, why don't you take this young guy, GNR was around 29 years old that time, already an assistant professor. I can assure you that he will do a great job. So at age 29-30, GNR left Bangalore, where he was actually for around 10 years, and where he actually had a scientific awakening. He moved from Bangalore to Madras. So he actually moved as a full professor and head of this Department of Physics in Madras University. And what he founded was this Department of Crystallography and Biophysics, which is still around today. I'll tell you about how this department has contributed a lot to Indian structural biology. So this is, he moved to 52 to 70. And many think that this is the time when he flourished. So although he was in ISC, he was in Cambridge, but this is where he came on his own, because he was sent at age 30 to establish a new institute, he wasn't ever in Madras actually. So he was in Trichy and then he went to Bangalore. And he was given all this responsibility. And given that we are in a new institution, like I just will play a short clip by him, which will resonate with many of you, hopefully. So, wait a minute. So there is this,
The appointment in Madras was rather unique for anybody in India at that time. Namely, that the department had reasonable amount of space, and no previous equipment was there, and no previous heritage was there, so that I could develop it just as I liked.
Raman was not able to appreciate the tremendous.
So yeah, so that is a documentary that the CSR actually commissioned, which I just played, and it's available on YouTube. I can share the link with you later. And it would be interesting to those of us who are in IITGM, because it can give us some inspiration. But he actually took that as a challenge, and he did a great job about it. So this, I found interesting that there was no heritage, because heritage is something which we often obsess about. So with that, at age 29, he moved there. He set up this group. And this is a picture which you will see in many places. So this was actually in 1955, so a few years after he formed his group. It had already grown. And some of these people who I have listed here are people who have done some of the important work that I will talk about soon. So this is his first postdoc, Kartha, who did the collagen structure I'll talk about. This is, and you will see these names later. This is Ambadi. This is Shashi Shekharan, who worked with him on the Ramachandran plot. Interestingly, I guess many of the physics people here, maths people here would know IMSC. And sitting next to him is Aladhi Ramakrishnan, who's the founder of IMSC. So this was a time when, you know, all these famous people who we've read about, you see them all in the same frame, which is pretty fascinating. So anyway, so this is the group that was set up, and I'm kind of jumping ahead of myself, but given the discoveries that this group made in those almost 20 years that JNR was in University of Madras, it was actually referred to as a Madras group of crystallography across the world. So in those 20 years, the Madras group was actually well known in the circles, in the top echelons of science in the context of crystallography. So it was always referred to as the Madras group. So coming to the first discovery, so there are many. I've decided to just focus on three, the first being the collagen structure, second being the Ramachandran plot. So the structure of collagen, so what is collagen? So I just gave you that very brief capsule on biomolecules with a focus on protein. Collagen is something which probably you're all very familiar with. You might still remember it from your school days. So it's actually the most abundant protein in our body. So we are made, like I said, we are a bag of molecules. We're just made up of carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids. And collagen is, in fact, the number is around 30%. One third of all the proteins of our body is collagen. It is a structural protein. So it's essentially what gives us the shape, our shape. So it's there in our skin, our bones, our tendons, ligaments, everywhere, which is why it is so abundant. Although it's such an abundant protein, the structure of collagen, so the actual molecular structure of a molecule of collagen was not known in the 50s. This was actually a very hard problem. So it's not like JNR does not take credit for thinking of this by himself. I guess we were just discussing in the previous panel that in those days, pre-independence, just post-independence, there was a lot of visits by many of these international leaders to the Indian scientific community. And the famous UK crystallographer, J.D. Bernal, who many of you may have heard about, did visit India around these early 50s, and JNR used to know him from his PhD days in Cavendish. So he visited JNR, and he in fact suggested that, why don't you work on collagen? So at that point, JNR was around 30 years old. He just started this very new department. He was doing this institution building, and he was looking for interesting problems for his group to work on. And Bernal suggested, yeah, why not go big? Like, why work on the low-hanging fruit? Go big, work on collagen. Why collagen? So he said, collagen, the structure of collagen has been tried. People in Cambridge are trying to work on it. Crick and Pauling, again, I guess these are almost iconic figures. Crick is the DNA discoverer. Pauling, of course, two Nobel Prizes. We'll come to them in a second. They have been trying working on collagen. They have been unsuccessful, but still try working on it. JNR took this up, interestingly. So sometimes assistant professors are told to not work on these high-risk projects, but JNR actually went the other way. He said, yeah, why not? Let me give it a shot. This was late 1952, early 1953, is when he got this idea. And he decided to set upon this journey with his first postdoc, Kartha, who I just showed you in the previous figure. So the first question they asked was, where do I get collagen? So, you know, collagen is a protein, it's abundant, and to do crystallography, you need tons of protein. Even today, the limiting factor sometimes to make a crystal is having a very highly concentrated solution of protein, which often is not very easy to get. So what he first did was walk down to the biochemistry department of the Madras University, and they had some shark fin collagen, so collagen from the fin of a shark. And this was not of high quality. So they tried to make crystals, they tried to diffract the crystals, they didn't work. So then he started talking to people, and they said that, oh, you can get collagen from the tail of a cow, you can get, and there were like several different suggestions he made. And then what JNR thought was, so if you've been to Chennai, you might have seen it's still there today. There are like these hubs of institutions. So right next to Madras University is the CLRI, the Central Leather Research Institute. It still stands today. The director of CLRI was Y. Nayadumma. He was also, just like the VC, was a very energetic, very helpful director. And what Nayadumma said is, what do you need? He said, so what JNR said was, leather is essentially, again, made of collagen. You are the CLRI. Can you give me some collagen? I just need collagen. Naidam and Sriyanathan did some research and they realized that the kangaroo tail tendon, so the tendon in the tail of a kangaroo from Australia, is apparently a very good source of collagen. How do you get it? What Nayadamma told him was, don't worry, I'll get it for you. And I couldn't find any reports on how he got it, but in those days, he managed to give him a tube of collagen from this kangaroo tail. He just handed it over to him right next door from CLR in Madras University. And that's what he used to. So that's the CLRI, it still stands, the CSR institution still in Madras. And that's what he used. So in less than 2 years, he was able to get a diffraction image. So this is the Ambadi, the other students from his lab, the diffraction image of collagen from this kangaroo tail tendon. And some of you who've seen X-ray diffraction images will be familiar with this. So this is what a raw diffraction image looks like, and then you can use, nowadays, of course, you can use software to finally get these atomic level structures. This was all from his paper, which I'll show you in a second. And essentially, in two lines, what he was able to show was collagen was, in fact, a coiled triple helical structure. So what is a trip? Is a helix? A helix is essentially three chains which twine around each other. And a very common analogy is the way women braid their hair. And I guess some people often joke about GNR that he got inspired by his wife's braid. And a lot of women in Tamil Nadu put flour in their hair. And I think he looked at that and he thought, that's probably like what collagen looks like. This is actually, again, this is an anecdote. I don't know if this is true, but it is very similar to the braid that women make. So there are three independent chains which are coiling around each other. Each of those are left-handed, but the entire helix is a right-handed helix around one common axis. So this was a structure which was not known before 1952. So, and that is why it was very path-breaking. So and I will show you the helical structures which were known at that point, including the DNA double helix. So this is again a picture of him teaching an audience. So this is exactly what it looks like. This is an artist's rendition. So you can see, you can appreciate how it looks like the braid of a braid of hair. And what is interesting is that for each of these chains, there's a glycine, which is the smallest amino acid, which faces the center of the axis. So this is like looking at the coil from the top down. And you can see that the glycines are forming the center, and you have these other residues, which in this case are a proline and hydroxyproline, yeah, right here on the outside. And again, there is another anecdote saying that the inspiration of him thinking about having these glycines around the center comes from astronomy, apparently. So apparently, he was looking at the moon going around the Earth, and the rotation revolution idea gave him a thought that, oh, so we only always see one face of the moon, and so the axis only sees glycine. So again, this is an anecdote which I read about. GNR is not around to validate that either. But no matter what, this model stands the test of time. So this braid-like structure of three minor left-handed helices twisting to form one major right-handed helix, which is essentially the structure of collagen, the most abundant protein in the body. So why was this important? Of course, now, like, the double helix is a popular science book. We hear about helices all the time. At that point in the world, in terms of the world stage, only two other types of helices were known. So this was the alpha helix, which is a right-handed helix, present in proteins like keratin, which is again a very abundant protein in the body. It's there in our hair. This was solved by the famous physicist, chemist, if you will, Linus Pauling in 1954. So around the same time, Pauling, GNR actually met in Cambridge. So he solved this, got a Nobel Prize for it also. Solved in 51, got the Nobel Prize in 3 years. And at the same time, of course, the most iconic helix of all times, at least as far as I'm concerned, is the DNA double helix. So it's a right-handed double helix, again solved in 53. So essentially at the same time, this is, of course, the famous diffraction pattern by Rosalind Franklin in 53. This Nobel came a few years later, and of course, many of you might have heard about the controversy connected to Rosalind Franklin, and we won't get into that. She passed away by the time this prize was given. This was given in physiology to Watson, Crick, and Wilkins. And so this is the double helix, and this is the alpha helix. What was unique to the collagen helix was it was a triple helix. Neither of these were triple helices, and it was a left-handed helix. Again, both of these were unknown at this point of time in the scientific community. So, of course, we were again talking about publications, and he had two back-to-back papers in, not back-to-back, a year after each other, in Nature, both interestingly of the same name, Structure of Collagen, with two authors. This was in 54 August, this came in a year later in 55. But what is interesting is, because we were talking about Indian journals, it seems like at that point of time, it was pretty common for Indian scientists to submit another version of the paper, there was no archive then, to an Indian journal. So there are versions of these papers which are available in those, in some of these Indian journals that were available at the time. I didn't put up those links but they are almost all the papers that he's published. He does have that publication in the foreign journal, Nature, PNAS, and so on, but he does have a corresponding paper, and I guess copyright and all that was less complicated in those days. I didn't go into read up more about that. So these two came out. How was it received in the scientific community is a question you may ask. So first of all, it was received with skepticism. And in fact, Crick of the DNA double helix fame, he also came, so interestingly, even this paper has the same name, Structure of Collagen. This also came out in 55. And they actually kind of tried to disprove the theory. So they didn't have a problem with the triple helix. This paper essentially tried to say that, in JNR's paper, he proposed that there were two hydrogen bonds between these, interchain hydrogen bonds between these helices. But Rich and Frank Crick in this paper, they said that would be, there would be steric constraints. So what steric constraint means is there would be some kind of a collision happening between these chains. And so it's just not possible for two chains to be that close to each other. And so there can only be one hydrogen bond. I haven't followed up all the literature, but I think what I understand is Rich and Crick have been proven wrong, and Ramachandran's collagen structure still holds true. However, if I was just looking at, so Rich passed away like 2 years ago, and I was looking at his obituary, and it actually says that he made several important discoveries, including solving the structure of collagen. So I haven't read too much about that. He was in MIT. Crick, of course, had many other things. They had many other things to write about, so they didn't write about collagen, but Rich somehow also gets that attribution that he apparently solved the structure. But if you look at it, the collagen structure is, we still know that it has two hydrogen bonds, and one of them is because of this occurrence of a hydroxyproline in the collagen, which needs an extra hydrogen bond. This is how we explained it. And it is we do know that it is a triple helix, it is a left-handed helix, and all of those have stood the test of time. And there are many more structural studies done till date. But what came out of this controversy was, so while he was trying to, so you notice that there were like two papers that he presented. So this was the first structure, and this was a refined structure. And in the second paper, which came kind of around the time of the Rich and Crick controversy, he addressed these complaints that Rich and Crick held. But what happened was that allowed him to start thinking about what is a minimum non-bonded distance between atoms that are not linked by covalent bonds? Because that was kind of the question that Rich and Crick were raising. So to do this, what he did was something very, very thorough. So, and it led to what is the second important discovery that we will be talking about, which is the Ramachandran plot. So what he essentially did was, so before I go into looking at these bonds, I'll just define some more parameters. So this is, again, from a standard textbook. So just to remind you, proteins are formed of amino acids. Amino acids are the basic unit of a protein. So these are amino acids which are essentially this is a C alpha, which is the, and this R is a group. So the reason that these are of different colors is because these groups can have different, so that is what gives identity to the amino acid. And this part in black is what is common between all amino acids. So it's a C here, which is connected to a C double bond O here and an NH group here. And these connect together, forming this peptide bond, which is shown here in green. So the CN is the peptide bond. So this is how two amino acids come together, and then a polypeptide chain has several amino acids. What was known at that time, and we still appreciate today, is that there are 2 degrees of freedom in a polypeptide chain. So if you look at this, again, this is just a representation of a polypeptide, wherein this is the peptide bond, this is a peptide bond here, the NC bond. shown over here, shown over here. So this is amino acid 1, amino acid 2, amino acid 3. So the angle between these two atoms, so the H here and the C alpha here, that's called the phi angle. And the angle between the C here and the H here is the psi angle. So these are the only two angles which give the protein the ability to move, if you will. So it's the rotations around these angles are essentially the phi rotation and the psi rotation are also called the torsion angles or the dihedral angles, are what give the protein the ability to move around in very simple English. So the degree of freedom is defined by these two angles. So what he decided to do, so this was already known, this definition of the torsion angles of amino acids in a polypeptide chain. So what he decided to do was, again, address that question raised by Rich and Crick. What is the minimum non-bonded distance between atoms not linked by covalent bonds? So he did an essential, so I guess students nowadays, we talk about literature review, right? That is something you do at the beginning of a research project. So what they did was they surveyed all crystal structures available at that time. So please note that there were no protein structures in this period of time. This is around early 60s. So the first crystal structure of a protein was myoglobin, which came around 62. This was before that. So there were just structures of small peptide chains, small peptides, which were available. But they were all available, the data was all available. So his students basically got together and they surveyed all these crystal structures. Even computers were pretty primitive then. So much of the calculations they were doing were manually on electronic typewriters, it seems. They sat and calculated and they looked for close contacts involving C, N, O, and H atoms, essentially in these peptide chains. And they calculated distances which approach, and what they found was that non-bonded atoms often approach each other more closely than the sum of their respective van der Waal radii. Which is what essentially Rich and Crick were trying to say. So they, in fact, doing this survey of all available structures, they were able to arrive at a set of allowed contact distances. So that they call that normal limit. And this is, they defined for various peptides. And then they saw that there was an extreme limit, which is sometimes possible, and a normal limit, which is usually possible. So this is the distance between two non-bonded atoms. And what they did was then, they came up with this very simple 2D representation of these phi and psi angles. So this is the famous Ramachandran plot. So on the x-axis here is the phi value, so the phi angle. The y-axis is the psi angle. And they plotted what they found from this survey they did of all crystal structures available at that time. And they were able to see that the allowed structures, or the favored structures, only fell in these three quadrants of this plot. Also, very interestingly, these are different kinds of protein structures. So beta sheet is a secondary structure element present in amino acids. It's a way in which amino acids can fold in a polypeptide chain. So beta sheet, a left-handed alpha helix, which is essentially what we just talked about, right-handed alpha helix we also talked about. These are different kinds of protein structures. So they have different allowed values of, so only certain values of psi and phi will give rise to an alpha helix, and so on. So this is, in very simple terms, what is the Ramachandran plot, representing the allowed conformations for a certain protein. And what they, so this was around that time, like I said, the first protein structure, so a full-length polypeptide chain of myoglobin, the structure came out. Everything they had done before that was theoretical and based on some of these peptide data that was available. So they validated this with the structure of this first and second protein structure, and they found that remarkably, this held true for these large polypeptide chains. So there were only certain allowed psi-phi value ratios for each of these specific secondary structure elements. And so, if you will, this can be defined as the grammar of protein structures. So just like the periodic table kind of defines, is kind of considered the grammar of chemistry, the Ramachandran plot is often called defines the grammar of how a protein, the structure of a protein. And it has stood the test of time. It is still used till date to confirm if a proposed structure is acceptable, because based on the sequence, you can predict secondary structure. And if that secondary structure of the proposed structure has abnormal, like wrong psi-phi values, you can say it's a bad structure. And that it is still routinely used, and I will show you some examples of that. So this is, again, from a textbook where you can see that. So another thing is, whatever is in dark green or dark red over here is most favored, and the periphery is less favored but still allowed. And everything else is not allowed. So if there is something, if you find a sci-fi angle ratio here, it's essentially a disallowed structure. So that is shown over here. So this kind of a conformation is not possible energetically in nature, because this red at this red over here, which is an R group, if it's present here, it would be disfavored because there would be probably a collision or a steric clash occurring. Yes, yes. Yeah, you're just, I'm just going, that is exactly what I'm going to talk about. So it's surprisingly true, so which is what, so this is a structure again in Current Science, an Indian journal from 1990, still almost more than 20 years ago, wherein you can see, they've actually compared the Ramachandran plot. So it's used even today, and I'll show you examples. So this is a bad quality structure wherein you see a lot of points in this quadrant, which is the disallowed quadrant of the Ramachandran plot. This is a structure of the hen egg white lysozyme. And this is a very good structure, wherein this part is relatively empty, and you see all of these points in these allowed regions with lots of points in these very favored regions. So it is used as a confirmatory tool even today. And this is a picture I got of the protein data bank yesterday. So the protein data bank is, or a database, is this online repository of all protein structures that are solved all over the world. So it is one of those nice resources of science, of open science, wherein as soon as you solve a structure, and now of course beyond crystallography, you have cryo-electron microscopy, NMR, various other methods to solve protein structures and get atomic coordinates. So you submit your coordinates to PDB. It's like submitting your paper to on archive. It is open, and you can immediately access it. So this is this graph, of course, is till 2010, but this number here is from yesterday. So when I looked yesterday, there were 156587 structures in protein data bank, and in 1962, when he made the Ramachandran plot, there was only one, which is myoglobin. So all of these structures, it's almost the first test that it passes. So the first test for a structure to be validated is the Ramachandran plot. And all of these, for all of these proteins, which are of diverse shapes, diverse lengths, they all fall, like their allowed regions all fall in this quadrant. So it's kind of used as that stamp, as a touchstone for validating if a protein structure is valid, even today. There has been no structure known that does not follow these basic 2D representation of sci-fi values. Yeah, yeah. So it is essentially, so why is, you can understand from here, one sec. So you, so this kind of figure, which I went over pretty quickly, kind of shows that. So here, this is a disfavored, sci-fi, wherein the sci-fi values fall in this quadrant. And you can see that if you twist, so essentially it's a degree of freedom, right? So if the molecule is rotated, and now you can actually get models which you can play with by your hand and make it move and see what happens if the phi value and the psi value is a certain number. And what happens then is this red group, which is not kind of intruding into the space in these two favored orientations, kind of comes in the way here. And it's easier to do this in, when you're doing it with 3D models. So people do this with 3D models all the time, where you can actually move around these bonds and see what a disfavored bond angle looks like. And you can then speculate that, oh, so this, if the phi angle is this and the psi angle is that, then this group will come and interfere with this and it'll disrupt the protein structure. And this is, of course, a long polypeptide chain. Here you're just looking at two, like a dipeptide or a tripeptide, but if you do, if this is a long polypeptide chain, it will really not work. So you can, nowadays you can, these are done routinely. You can just make models and see how it could affect. Any other questions? Yeah.
How does the transition between two molecules work?
Transition as in? Yeah.
Give energy to the cis molecule, it becomes a trans molecule.
Yeah.
So how is it understood that the how does the transition work? Like, is it a smooth transition?
I don't know that. Yeah. Like I said, I'm not. Yeah. I don't know how it was. Can anybody answer that question? There are. Any other question? That I don't know. So I can. Energetically, I don't know. Yeah. Oh, so you also don't know. So then that if Shudipto doesn't know, then no one knows probably. Yeah. Okay. So just to wrap it up, it still holds a test of time. So even today, all the structures that have been solved till date, it will be validated by the Ramachandran plot. So anyway, so this was again published in JMB, Journal of Molecular Biology, in 1963. These were the two scientists who worked with him, Shashi Shekharan and Ramakrishnan. So moving on, so in addition to, so we talked about the structure of collagen, we talked about the Ramachandran plot very briefly. In addition to all of this, he was working on various aspects of crystallography, which I will not get into, including anomalous dispersion, molecular modeling, and so on. He also, in fact, worked on this theoretical method, which involving convolution, and don't ask me what convolution is, which essentially reconstructed 3D images to 2D images, and this is essentially the foundation for what is computerized tomography. So basically, CT scans, MRI, all of that comes from this theoretical method, which, again, an interesting anecdote is after he came up with this paper, which was in fact published in PNAS in 1971. I also saw this was communicated by Chandrasekhar from U Chicago of the Chandrasekhar Limit. So he was in fact in U Chicago as a visiting professor often, and in 1970 he was in U Chicago. And, so this is the same Chandrasekhar who communicated this paper in PNAS. But very interestingly, apparently he did approach funding agencies at the time with this theoretical paper to get funding to do it to the experimental work, and it never got funded. So the CT, he had this idea that you could actually build a machine which can be used to do this and then essentially carry out CT scans and so on. But this was never funded, and this was again done later by other people, not in India, outside India. But this was one of the first theoretical papers which talked about convolution of 3D reconstruction. But I will not get into details of that. So before I just leap on to other parts of JNR's life, I just thought I'd leave you with this quote from Marie Curie, which is a personal favorite. So Curie has said many things, but one of the things she said is, for her, the pure motivation was pure science. At that point, it wasn't the application. And that is also true for Ramachandran's work. So he was working on a problem just out of curiosity, not because it had an application. And what she said was, the beauty of science is, the usefulness of it can come later, and which is also true for all of Ramachandran's research ideas, including the Ramachandran plot and, of course, the last bit I just talked about. So with that, I'll just move on from, very briefly, I told you about some scientific discoveries of GNR, but just give you some snapshots of his life beyond the lab. So he was, of course, a very capable administrator because he built, and I will talk about some other institutes which he also built. And another thing he was very well known for was being able to hound a lot of people to come to Madras. So there was this Madras group, which everyone knew about, but what he also organized was these famous Madras conferences. He held two, in fact, in 63 and 67. And in this picture, actually, you'll see all the who's who of structural biology. So just to give you a blow up, so this is Dorothy Hodgkin, Nobel Prize 64. For solving the structures of using crystallography of penicillin and B12. This is Pao Ling himself, chemistry alpha helix. This is the famous VC I was talking about, Mudaliar, who essentially helped bring GNR from Bangalore to Madras. Also here is, I think Harold Sharaga is over here. He's still alive, in fact. He's also a very well-known chemist, physicist, theoretical physicist, and many other famous people. He held two of these very famous Madras conferences during his tenure in Madras. What he also did was very actively, he would reach out to any physicist who was visiting India. So this is a letter which I found, which he co-wrote with Alladi Ramakrishnan, in fact, to Paul Dirac. He heard he's coming, I think, to Calcutta at that point. He had already won the Nobel Prize, of course. This was 54. And this is a long letter where he invites him to come to Madras, see their group, and interact with the kids. So this is his long letter. Several visitors came throughout this time. So this is again Hodgkin, Pauling, Paul Dirac is part of that visit, who all came and visited the group. And that's how the Madras group became well known across the world. But what happened around this time? So like all scientific stories, there is a lot of gossip, so to say. So in 1970, what happened is the Mudaliar, the VC of Madras, he resigned. He resigned, and there was a new VC who came to University of Madras, and there. So his views and his philosophy and his vision was very different from the previous VC. They essentially didn't match with GNR's vision. And this was almost 20 years after he reached Madras. So he had different, so they essentially did not get along that well. And at around this time, he decided to leave, leave, and so he used to keep visiting University of Chicago for short sabbaticals, but he decided to go for a year at this point. And when he came back, he didn't come back to Madras. He moved back to ISC Bangalore. But at this point, he was already very, very well known. So he went back as the professor and head of this new unit that he set up, the Molecular Biophysics Unit, which still is a very, very reputable unit of structural biology in India today. So he went back to ISC and from the University of Madras. And so now he's basically well known for establishing two centers of structural biology. This still stands today. And this is a molecular biophysics unit, which he set up in 1971 as a professor and head. So he spent the rest of his career here. So essentially from, so 71 to 78, he stayed with MBU. But what happened, another very interesting part of his life about which I couldn't find much information, was the last 20 odd years of his life, he completely moved away from science. And that is, if you just read various reports from various scientists today, is part of the reason why people think he did not get acknowledgement. I don't know if this is again true, we can debate this for hours. So essentially the last 20 plus years, he essentially retired from the MBU unit in 1978. And from 78 to 81, he was an institute professor of mathematical philosophy. Then he became distinguished scientist, and then he became the Albert Einstein Professor of Mathematical Philosophy, all in ISC. But he'd completely stopped working in physics, crystallography, structural biology. He was I think that was pretty common from scientists of that age, that they were essentially these Renaissance men. They had a wide variety of interests beyond their domain. So he was interested in classical music, both from India and the West. Philosophy, logic, as well as poetry. He did write poetry. I'll show you some examples later. And but then what some people do discuss, and these are actually scientists who are still alive today, that he probably, since he completely retired from active research, and this was not, he was still in his late 50s, early 60s at this point of his career. He stopped traveling to conferences, he stopped lobbying, and I don't know if any of this is true, we can again debate, and he stopped working in science. And that is probably one of the reasons why he was forgotten and we don't hear about him so much. I do not know enough to support or refute that. It is true that he essentially is not known. He doesn't have that iconic status. And he hasn't won many of these national awards. So Nobel Prize, of course, he never did win. And we think all of us agree that he should have won it. He did win the Bhatnagar Award in kind of during the peak of his career. But he didn't win any of these other awards like Padma Shri, Padma Vibhushan, which many of these other icons have won. He did the fellows of several societies, including the Royal Society, very late in his life, just 2 years before he passed away, and also the Ewald Prize from the IUC in 1999. And in fact, very interestingly, there's a Gadhinagar connection also, which I found out just yesterday. So he, of course, has a huge legacy of various scientists who are his progeny, scientific progeny, but his biological progeny are also very illustrious, as expected. So his daughter is currently a professor of computer science in UT Austin, another son in astronomy in Harvard, and a third son apparently is in Gandhinagar in the Plasma Physics Institute. And in his, around 97, 98, he moved because of old age. He actually moved to Gandhinagar for a year. And his wife actually passed away in Gandhinagar. So he spent a year here. But after she passed away, he just refused to stay here. He wanted to go back to Bangalore because he was missing his community there. And he ended up living in Bangalore for the last two or three years of his life. And he actually had very advanced Parkinson's disease. So the last years of his life were pretty, in that sense, sad. And he passed away in 2001, actually, in Bangalore itself. So I'll end with this poem he had written. So I said he was interested in poetry. I could just find one after a lot of searching, which he actually wrote about Linus Pauling. So Linus Pauling and the alpha helix. interesting poem of all biopolymers. You can, I can share this with you later. And finally, although he's not reached that iconic status, there are some, there are gradual efforts, mainly from the Chennai-Bangalore community to remember him. So this is essentially a road in within the IBAB in Bangalore. This is the CLRI auditorium. It's called the Triple Helix Auditorium. This is one of the kind of symbols on the MBU website. So the MSc students of MBU designed this in ISC with his alpha helix and the collagen and so on, and the Ramachandran plot, of course. And finally, I'd just like to thank the various sources. If you do have the time, please watch this YouTube video, which is CSR produced. It's a very interesting video. It's not hagiographic in nature. It's pretty well done, many of these articles. And also, I would like to thank some of these, Professor Krishnaswamy, who in fact was my MSc supervisor and actually worked in Madras University and sent me a lot of material and helped me design this talk, and Professor Gautam Menon, who was also here a few weeks ago, who also gave me a lot of interesting anecdotes about GNR. Yeah, with that, I'll stop and take some questions.